knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Over the past few tutorials, we've learned that when faced with a challenging differential equation, we can either try to find clever substitutions to convert the problem into a known form, or we can just brute force an approximate numerical solution with a computer. But there's also a technique that can be seen as a sort of blending of these two extremes, and that is the power series method. Power series can be used to solve any nth order linear differential equation, which is quite a large class of problems. For a second order DE, we will write this as y double prime plus p of x times y prime plus q of x times y equals r of x. Recall that we can express any continuous function f of x as an infinite series of powers of x using Maclaurin series, or Taylor series, if we expand about a point other than zero. And this can help us find a power series solution for y of x, where we want to find the coefficients a sub n of the series for y, expanded about a given point x equals x zero. What this means is that we will be able to express the solution to our DE as an infinite sum, just like a Taylor series. Let's see how with an example. Suppose we want to find the series expansion about x equals 0 for y double prime minus x times y equals 0, which is a differential equation known as the Airy equation, subject to the initial conditions y of 0 equals 1 and y prime of 0 equals 2. First, we write a power series for y. Y equals the sum from n equals 0 to infinity of the unknown coefficients a sub n times x to the n, and differentiate it using the power rule. Notice that although the series for these derivatives now appear to include terms with negative powers of x, these terms always evaluate to zero because the factor n will be zero in the front, and some sources will start these summations at a higher index to avoid this confusion. Either way, we can substitute into our differential equation. We first need to absorb the terms outside the summation into our x to the n terms, which we can do in the second term here, increasing the power by 1. Next, we need to make sure all our summations have the same exponent in their x to n terms, which they currently do not. In the second summation, we can perform re-indexing. If we replace n with n minus 3, the power becomes n minus 2 to match the first summation. But to compensate for this, we need to start this summation 3 steps later at n equals 3. Next, we need to make sure all our summations have the same starting index, which they again currently do not. In the first summation, we can pull out the first three terms corresponding to n equals 0, which gives 0, n equals 1, which also gives 0, and n equals 2, which gives 2 times a2. Then we can combine the summations to get the following. In order for this expression to be 0, both the pulled out terms at the start and every term under the summation must all be 0, so we can find that the term a2 equals 0, and we also get a recurrence relation, n times n minus 1 times an minus an minus 3 equals 0. This is a relationship between the terms of our series solution, and we can solve for an to get an equals an minus 3 over n times n minus 1. It's now time to use our initial conditions. If we compare our power series coefficient an to the coefficients in the Maclaurin series for y, we see that an is the same as the nth derivative of y at x equals 0 divided by n factorial, since this is the coefficient of x to the n in the Maclaurin series definition. Since we know y of 0 and y prime of 0 from the initial conditions, we can find a0 and a1, and we get a0 equals 1 and a1 equals 2. Recall from earlier that we also managed to find a2 equals 0, so we can use these starting values to iterate through our sequence an using the recurrence relation we found. We can then use our recurrence relation to find the rest of the terms in the sequence, and we get the following power series solution for y, which will be valid within some radius of convergence, which turns out to be everywhere for this problem. If we were not given initial conditions for this problem, and we wanted to find the two fundamental basis solutions, we could achieve this by simply choosing two different sets of initial conditions and iterating the sequence in each case, with each sequence producing a different basis solution, and the most conventional choice is to choose y of 0 equals 1 and y prime of 0 equals 0 for one solution, and y of 0 equals 0 and y prime of 0 equals 1 for the other solution. There is a shortcut to this process, however, known as the Leibniz method, or sometimes the Leibniz-Maclaurin method, and it exploits something called the general Leibniz rule. This states that if we have a product of two functions, f and g, and we want to differentiate it n times, which would normally take a while by using the product rule, we can write it in this form here, which is basically the binomial theorem from algebra, but with powers replaced with derivatives. Let's now see how the Leibniz method works with the same example as last time. We start with y double prime minus xy equals 0, with the initial conditions y of 0 equals 1 and y prime of 0 equals 2. It will be helpful to quickly change the derivative notation to match that in the formula above. What we now need to do is take our differential equation and differentiate both sides with respect to x n times. The y double prime term will become y differentiated n plus 2 times, which we will write in this notation. But for the xy term, we need to use our general Leibniz rule to find the nth derivative of xy. The nth derivative of xy will be the sum from k equals 0 to n of the binomial coefficient nk times x differentiated k times times y differentiated n minus k times. If we expand out all n terms of this summation, we observe that the zeroth derivative of x is x, the first derivative of x is 1, and the second derivative of x is 0, with all higher derivative terms also being 0, so only the first two terms remain. We get the nth derivative of xy as x times y differentiated n times plus n times y differentiated n minus 1 times. Continuing from where we left off, we now have our dE that has been differentiated n times. This dE is valid for all values of x, so now we just plug in x equals 0, as this is where we are expanding our power series. The middle term goes away, and we get the following equation, where all derivatives of y are evaluated at x equals 0. Recall again from the definition of the Maclaurin series that our desired coefficients, a sub n, are equal to the nth derivative of y evaluated at 0 divided by n factorial, which we will rearrange for the derivatives of y at 0. We can now use this formula to convert our current equation, which is in terms of the derivatives of y at 0, into an equation relating the unknown power series coefficients, a n. We can replace n times n minus 1 factorial with n factorial, divide both sides by n plus 2 factorial, simplify the factorial fraction, and rearrange for a sub n plus 2. Lastly, we can re-index by subtracting 2 from all our n's, and we get our recurrence relation, which is the same answer as last time with quite a lot less work. This time, in order to find the value of a2, we need to return to the original differential equation, y double prime minus xy equals 0, and plug in x equals 0, and this gives y double prime of 0 equals 0, and so a2 is 0, and this gives us our particular series solution. It is sometimes possible to write out a neat formula for the coefficients an by identifying patterns in the terms as we evaluate them, and writing the terms in an unsimplified way can often help reveal what the pattern is. It's not always possible, though, and in fact, for the example shown, it's practically impossible. It is also sometimes possible to compare the coefficients to well-known Maclaurin series expansions, such as for sine of x and e to the x, in order to go from a series solution to a solution with ordinary functions. This is most likely to be feasible when working out the general solution, where the two fundamental basis solutions tend to correspond to simpler functions, like sine and cosine. Let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.